Science. It's how we know our place in the universe, how we know what natural phenomena are, how we know what this thing was, how we know how to not die at the ripe old age of 36, and how we know how to write complex mathematical equations to determine how a ball rolls down a hill. Because of science, we were able to go from this to this, which is honestly a pretty good thing. In fact, those two images were only 500 years apart. So, what happened about 500 years ago that changed the course of our modern world? By the way, this video is part of a huge collaboration between a bunch of YouTube history channels called Project Revolution, hence the intro. Now, most of these people, whose videos you should absolutely check out once you're done with this one, are covering revolutions that birthed new nations and changed other nations forever. And while that is, like, totally my thing, I decided I'd cover a slightly different kind of revolution. The scientific revolution obviously didn't topple any regimes, at least on its own, nor was it necessarily one single event, but a whole paradigm shift taking place over a couple hundred years. Granted, only intellectuals really knew it would have even been happening at the time, but it's still consequential. Before the scientific revolution, most scientific knowledge in the ancient world, or at least in Europe, was based on the teachings of various Greek and Roman scientists and philosophers, like Aristotle, Ptolemy, and Galen, who all had one thing in common. They were kind of wrong about everything. Granted, everything they said certainly seemed plausible at the time and was probably the best they could have done, but by the middle of the second millennium AD, it was starting to become clear that they weren't necessarily right about everything they taught. Back then, the scientific method was a long way from being invented, so basically everything that made sense was good enough. Of course, the most well-known instance of this is with Ptolemy's geocentric model of the solar system, which described the Earth as one single giant stationary sphere in the middle of the universe, of which everything else orbited. The other planets, the sun, the stars, everything. This model of the heavens was basically the general model throughout the ancient world, and was actually debunked by many different scientists, but the only one of them people actually seemed to have listened to was Nicolaus Copernicus, and his heliocentric model of the solar system. You know, for being right. Well, it was actually full of tiny flaws that made the calculations infeasible, but nothing that couldn't be fixed up by later scientists. That is kind of the basis of science, after all, measuring data and improving on work done by others. Copernicus, and many other astronomers at the time, made many revolutionary discoveries in the field, and they were all rewarded for their contributions to human civilization by being arrested for heresy. The church, all churches, Catholic and Protestant, didn't really like the idea of Earth not being the center of everything, because, I mean, if they were wrong about their place in the universe, what else could they be wrong about? Galileo was sentenced to house arrest, and Copernicus actually got away with it, but only by dying just after his book, On the Revolutions of the Heavenly Spheres, was published in 1543. Giordano Bruno, of course, also argued that the other stars in the sky were no different from our sun, or, well, relatively speaking, and could thus have their own planets, possibly even with their own life forms. So, arguing that this would mean that humanity wasn't the pinnacle of creation, the church, of course, burned him at the stake. So, if these early astronomers had such a hard time convincing their peers of this new model, what eventually changed? Basically, overwhelming evidence. After Copernicus published his book, other astronomers discovered more arguments in favor of the heliocentric model. For one, Galileo discovered that Jupiter had at least four different moons of its own, at least four, which orbited it without a care in the universe for whether or not Earth existed. The phases of Venus were also discovered to have had nothing to do with the Earth, but everything to do with the Sun. Eventually, opposition to the heliocentric model started to fade, with heliocentric works finally starting to be unbanned in the church by 1758, as the church's influence was also starting to fade with the Enlightenment. Now, it's pretty easy to confuse the scientific revolution with the Enlightenment, but they are different things. The scientific revolution was a paradigm shift in how we did science, whereas the Enlightenment was more of a philosophical and religious movement that took place a bit later, often touted as an extension of the former. So, even if you don't care much about space, why should you care about all this? Well, first off, why don't you care about space? Second, while the scientific revolution might not have been a revolution in the traditional sense, it did still change how we think about the world. And while this may not have been something initially known about by the common person, the new knowledge brought on by the series of events did eventually come down to the common person. Nowadays, not only do we all know about how the solar system works, no one would even think to keep that knowledge from us. At least, no one whose theories actually work out. It wasn't just math, physics, and astronomy that saw significant advancements during this time though, but things like biology and chemistry, which are both definitely more helpful in the whole not pushing the average lifespan down to 30 department. Speaking of which, the study of human anatomy also expanded from merely the teachings of Galen, who, like we, never actually dissected a human body. This whole paradigm shift can be seen in the motto of the Royal Society, founded in 1660, Nullius in Verba, meaning on the word of no one. If you find through your own research that an old teaching is bad, reject it and replace it with the better finding. Just because something may already work somewhat decently doesn't mean it can't still be improved. This way of thinking, of calling the authority of past sources and high officials into question, would start to become the dominant way of thinking around the world for the next few hundred years, indirectly starting many numerous revolutions all across the planet. If you want to learn more about some of those revolutions, might I point out that this video is actually part of a huge group collaboration between myself and some amazing history YouTubers called Project Revolution. Click here to watch the previous video from Soliloquy, and here for the next from The Cynical Historian. Be sure to check out the rest of the playlist, and subscribe to learn something new every Sunday.